Sushi Boat is a fantastic looking game with over-the-top components and a very fun theme that is also more unforgiving than we expected.
Sushi Boat was designed by Dario Massarenti and Francesco Testini. Features mouth-watering artwork from Even Kwan and was published by Japanime Games in 2023 after a rather successful Kickstarter. And we have to thank Japanime Games for providing us with a review copy of this game.
This is all-you-can-eat sushi-inspired board game, plays 2 to 5 players, with games taking about 15 minutes per player, which is true pretty much from your first game.
While the concept and mechanics here are quite simple and the theme is silly and light, Sushi Boat has a very tight economy and can be quite unforgiving. This is especially true at higher player counts, with the 5-player game being quite brutal.
So in Sushi Boat, players are patrons at an all-you-can-eat conveyor boat-style sushi restaurant. Each turn, new sushi is added to the awesome wooden conveyor board, and players will, in turn, select a seat, take an action, and then eat some sushi. Actions include tipping the staff for a bonus and ordering side dishes, which can be eaten for special actions. The goal is to eat the most different kinds of sushi you can, with bonuses given for eating from the same colored plates in a row. The trick is you can never look through your plate stack, so you have to remember what you ate. And also remember to watch for the plates on the board for when a wasabi challenge comes up.
Now, the first thing anyone is going to notice about Sushi Boat is the over-the-top production quality, which features some things we have never seen before, like the wooden conveyor board, the chopstick holder-style component box, a ceramic plate to hold wasabi cubes, a plastic money tray for your yen, plastic plates with dome-like sushi stickers on them, and more.
Yeah, the card quality here is also great, and the rulebook is one of the most clear we've seen. Mo may correct me here, but I actually think that we did not play Extreme on this game on our first go. As an added bonus, there's a 2-sided menu sheet that explains all the different types of yummy sushi that are portrayed in the game.
Yeah, I keep going back. We've checked the rulebook multiple times. You've read it, and I've read it, and so far, I don't think we messed anything up.
Weird.
Now you start Sushi Boat by filling the wooden board with sushi and making an initial stack of 3 plates for the garbage. You place random staff tiles next to the specified seats on the board and set up the side dish deck as indicated in the rulebook.
Each player takes a mat, the matching colored pan, and 2 yen from the supply. If you're using the optional menu card rules, each player is dealt 2 menus. They choose one and return the other to the box.
Each turn in Sushi Boat starts by flipping up the next side dish card. Each card indicates how much sushi you add to the conveyor belt. It's either just enough to fill the track or enough so that one plate will go off the end and get placed into the garbage stack.
Next, players choose where to sit. The options available are based on the player count. If a player wants a spot that's already taken, they can give that player who has the seat 1 yen to take their spot.
And that's seating on the board. You don't actually have to get up and move around. Now, once seated, the player takes 1 action. You can take 1 yen. You can buy the face-up solo side dish card, which can be played at any time, plus could be worth points at the end of the game. Or you can meet with a staff member.
Now, when you tip them, each staff member does something different. The Nico lets you take a plate out of the trash. Kind of gross. Satsuki lets you take 2 plates out of the draw bag and place 1 on the top or bottom of your plate stack. Sakura gives you a wasabi cube, etc.
So one side note, you don't actually tip the staff. You meet with the staff. When I described the game and taught the game, I said tipping and it fits in this way people tend to think of it. But the actual rules are you are meeting with the staff. There are also a couple special actions you can take. You can place a special order, adding 1 plate to the conveyor. Or you can draw 2 new menu cards and keep 1 of them if using that rule option.
After taking your 1 action, you then get to eat sushi. Take the plate next to you where you are sitting and add it to the growing stack on your player mat. Note you can't ever look through your plates. You need to try and remember what you've already eaten. Play then passes to the next player who flips up the next side dish card and so on.
Mixed in with the side dishes are 4 wasabi challenge cards. When one of these comes up, play stops and you play a little mini game where everyone tries to guess what colored sushi plates are currently under the tunnel at the end of the game board. Correct guesses give players wasabi cubes, which are worth points at the end of the game.
Game continues until a player flips over the last side dish card. They finish the turn as normal, and then everyone totals their points. In Sushi Boat, you get points for sets of the same colored plates you've collected in order, sets of different types of sushi you've eaten, your wasabi, and any menu cards you've completed.
The player with the most points wins. Overall, rather thematic and not hard to understand or learn.
Now, with the theme of eating as much sushi and side dishes as you can, abilities like having a cat go dumpster diving, yuck, and the entire wasabi challenge thing, I expected Sushi Boat to be a silly family weight game, and I was a little off on that. While the theme is awesome and it can be quite fun, this can be a rather unforgiving game, especially when you use the optional menu rules. And it gets more difficult the more people you play with. Once you play with four or five players, you'll find you do not get enough turns and won't end up collecting nearly as many plates as sushi as you expect.
I think tight is the word that I've heard used to describe this most. And while I'm not sure I agree that's the right word, I'm not sure what else you'd call it.
Right. Like, I've been fumbling around all week. Mo and I've been going back and forth on this, trying to find a better word, and I'm still stuck at the word tight. Like, maybe unforgiving? It's exceptionally tight turn optimization that is required to do well in this game.
So, to that end, as an example of this, right, we first played Sushi Boat at Gamma Expo. I thought we played a demo game using a limited deck. Now, we sat down to a full game with five players. Now, the main complaint with the people playing, including Deanna and I, was that at the end of the game, some of the menu goal cards we had were impossible to complete. And that's not an exaggeration. There was no way to complete some of them. Now, at the time, the table agreed this must be due to playing a demo, and they shortened it. And we even told the demo person, like, hey, if you do a demo with anyone else, you might want to keep those menu cards out.
Right. Like, I assume that this is unfinished and this is impossible feeling was because it was a shortened demo game. But it turns out that is just the way this game plays.
Yeah, because a few weeks later, when I got my own copy of the table, we had the exact same problem. Like, even if the menu cards you get aren't impossible, they're hard. To be able to score most of them, you have to play literally perfectly. You can't take a single plate of the wrong color, and you can't waste a single yen. Now, this is also true when you're trying to get that full set of sushi. There are seven types of sushi in the game, and you're going to eat one a turn. There's no room for errors in Sushi Boat, and honestly, that's not what I want from a game with such a great theme and family-friendly appeal.
Yeah, the complex requirement for near-perfect play is a stark contrast to the friendly table presence that the game has. Seeing these beautiful components, thinking about a relaxing sushi dinner, but being forced to focus on every move to maximize that potential, as well as tracking every dish on the boat, is not the relaxing zen experience I was expecting when I saw this beautiful game laid out.
Yeah, and just as you guys were saying that, a thought occurred to me that I hadn't had before. It's the part where you're getting the sushi set, and then if you start on a second set, it's worth zero. Two cards is worth zero. Plates. If you collect three plates, it's only going to be worth one. You have to get to, which you're not going to get seven plus four plates. That's just ridiculous because you're never getting to 11 plates in this game. It's the lack of reward for getting anything over that set of the initial set of I've managed to get my seven sushi just kind of feels eh. It's weird because I tend to like games where you need to figure out how to maximize your turns. Like, I usually enjoy that solve the puzzle feeling there, but here it feels like it doesn't match the expectations or the tone of the game.
So the thing is, with what you're saying there, is you can collect way more than 7 or 11 plates even. The thing is, we were playing at the higher player counts, 4 and 5, and I wish I'd tried the game with fewer players. Fortunately, Dan and Sean haven't tried it with less players, because it ends up, when you play with less players, you get more turns. And more turns means more chances to use the staff to get extra plates. In my last two-player game, I collected 14 plates of sushi by the end of the game. Almost made two complete sets of sushi and easily completed my menu card. Now, Gwen, my opponent, managed to complete two out of three menu cards she collected and only missed out on the one because she made a memory mistake, not because she couldn't do it.
Yeah, that's a whole different experience. It sounds like a completely different game than the one I played at 5 or I watched at 4. That just doesn't sound like the game. And I don't know, it's weird because to me, sushi is a social experience more than anything. As much as I like eating sushi, going out for sushi with people is an experience in itself. And this game, the more people you have, the less you can focus on them, and the more you have to focus on this absolute, game optimization.
All right. I knew that when you played it with Gwen, you said it was looser, but I had no clue you actually managed to collect 14 plates. Yes. That's a whole new world. Like, we've been talking about this a lot, trying to figure out if we were playing something wrong or to figure out exactly what was going on with this game. And two players, that seems to have fixed it.
Yeah. And three, you probably won't get the 14, but you will easily get 10. Well, easily, as long as there are staff members out where you can buy extra plates. I did the math on that one too, and it ends up you always have at least one, probably more than one. Now, I don't know if this is part of the root cause of this problem. So there seems to be something wonky. This game was kickstarted very successfully, and the game changed from the Kickstarter version to when it was produced. And I wonder if that had an impact on this. The Kickstarter says you get two actions every turn instead of one. That's huge. But then I noticed eating sushi is actually an action. Now they remove that, and it seems to make sense, because now you take one action, then you automatically eat. But that's a subtle change that could affect how many plates people can and will eat, especially with people that let you take plates from both sides. I also noticed the menu cards were actually a stretch goal, not something that was included in the original game. So maybe they haven't been play tested as much as the rest of the game. Plus, they added more side dish cards to the game through stretch goals, which changes the balance of that deck. And I noticed when I look on the Kickstarter and it says set up how many cards to remove. Well, that's different than my copy of the game says. So I think something might have broken a little bit there when they were behind it. Now, what I feel like is if you are playing five player, just ditch the menu cards. Like, to me, they're not meant for a five player game. They are meant for less. Plus, it's going to slow down the game because people have more to think about. Or whoever made the menu card should have a list of like suggested player count. Like, you know how many games have components, say 4+, 5+? I would like to have seen that on the menu cards. Because with five players, it's almost impossible to get those ones that collect 8 plates, and it's definitely impossible to collect the ones that require 10.
Yeah, there are definitely menu goal cards that are impossible with five players, or if not impossible, extremely improbable. Like, it's heavily reliant not just on playing perfectly, but also there's a luck component there. So both of those have to gel for you to be able to pull it off.
Now, the other big potential concern with Sushi Boat is memory. This is very much a memory game. You need to remember what you ate. You have to remember what's in your stack. You need to keep track of what plates are under the tunnel on the board, because the next card could be a wasabi challenge. And then you throw in the menu card, and some of the menu cards are eat the most of this, have the least of this, have the most wasabi. Well, wasabi is obvious, but when it's eat the most lobster tails, you got to watch what players are taking what types of sushi and keep that in your head along with everything else. That's a lot of things to keep in your head at once. And another problem, and Sean kind of alluded this to a bit with his talk about going out with a group of players and having to focus. One of the problems with this game as far as remembering is it means you have to focus on the game, often intensely. This is not something to me that you want from a light party game for sure. And it's probably not something you want for family game night.
Yeah, exactly. This is the aspect that soured the game for me. And I got a feel for this even before playing it, as when I met up with you guys and watched you as a family play the game before I even got a chance to try it for myself. The gameplay is not matching what the components and the setup and the look of this game offers to me. There's just a disconnect.
Yeah. Every time I start chatting and enjoying the experience of playing the game, a wasabi challenge comes up and I'm reminded that I need to be paying closer attention.
Now, I realize we've been a bit harsh so far, but I think those criticisms are what people need to know if they're considering picking up Sushi Boat. Overall, even with these potential problems, I've enjoyed the game, even at the higher player counts. I just didn't love it. It wasn't until the time I sat down and played the game with two players that I found the game I was initially looking for.
Of course, one of the biggest takeaways for me is still this memory aspect. And judging by some of what I saw reading up on this, it's probably going to be the deciding factor for a lot of players. It's an aspect of the game that is going to be there regardless of the player count and the menus and scarcity or not.
Yeah, I don't hate the memory aspect. There's not a ton of things you have to remember, but as I said, it changes the tone of the game from something that's light and fun to something where you need to pay close attention.
Now, sticking with the positives on this game does look fantastic. Sushi Boat is probably one of the most visually appealing games in my collection now. I really do appreciate the deluxe components. And no, this isn't a deluxe edition. Every version of the game comes with this. I love the tinking sound, adding those wasabi cubes to the ceramic bowl. The coin plate is awesome for passing around the table. Hey, take your yen. The whole wooden boat conveyor system is awesome. I love the way the plates of the sushi look. They're little plastic plates, but they have this like puffy sticker on it that kind of looks like sushi under a glass dome. The visual nature of this game has proved to be great for public play events.
Yeah, there's no question that above all, this game is an attention getter. It's hard not to look at this game and wonder about it. What is it? How does it play? What is it offering?
I mean, honestly, that's why we're reviewing it. It had that effect on me. Yeah. So the game is super eye-catching. It's easily one of the neatest looking games in our collection. And even if you take the wooden sushi boat board and you put it aside, the trays for the pieces, they're awesome. Like when we tried the game at Gamma Expo, I assumed they had just put out neat bowls for the demo, and I was really surprised to discover that those bowls were standard issue.
Overall, too, I dig the feel of the game. I like it's one of those, it just feels good. I like it. I'm eating sushi, I'm stacking plates. I like the way the mechanics tie into the theme. Yeah, there's some weird stuff. Like, I'm pretty sure when you go to an all-you-can-eat sushi place, you don't swap seats to grab your sushi. Though I have been at one with boats where someone did reach over me to grab something. And I got to say, using an action to gain a yen's a little weird. Like, what are you going in the back and doing some dishes for a turn? I don't know. But the entire concept of meeting with the staff, which we always talk about, you tip the staff to get a bonus. To me, that makes more sense. Collecting different colored plates and the plates even being different colors, which at the place we were at wasn't all you can eat, but it meant different prices. Trying everything you can. You want to try every different piece. Okay, maybe that's not that thematic because there are certain types of sushi I avoid. But anyway, I get it. And even just having the biggest plate of wasabi bragging rights, like, look how much wasabi I ate. I got to go grab some milk. It just gives me the feeling of being at a sushi conveyor restaurant.
Well, I do love me some sushi. I've never actually tried conveyor or boat style restaurant, so I can't comment on the authenticity of it.
Meh. I've yet to eat at a conveyor belt restaurant and enjoy the experience. But that doesn't detract from the game and the fact that every time I play this, it makes me crave sushi so bad.
I gotta say, it makes me want to fix that and take Sean out for boat sushi at some point and hope the place we went to before has gotten better over the years. Now, one of the bonuses of this game being thematic, and we've talked about this on our episodes about teaching games and how to remember game rules, is that tying the theme to the mechanics makes it easy to teach. People get the concept of pick a seat and then maybe order a side dish, then eat the sushi that's in front of your seat. People are always amused when I say, just like a real all-you-can-eat place, it can be hard to remember what you've eaten when I'm explaining the rules about never looking through your plates. I also found the rules stick in people's heads due to the thematic tie-in. Like, we brought the game out with my family a month between games, and we were all able to jump back in right away with only minor reminders.
Yeah, the rules are simple and they all just thematically make sense. It's super easy to teach and remember.
Now, while Sushi Boat wasn't quite what I wanted at first, I knew it was a solid game. I could tell, like, there was definitely some design work here and it was well play tested. But man, it is way more difficult to play well than I expected, especially at the higher player counts. Now, what this is for those players who like highly competitive play, where you can really outplay your opponents and feel like you earn the victory, Sushi Boat's going to appeal to that crowd.
I don't know. I mean, I usually am that super competitive player, but I think I wanted something more casual from this one.
For groups that aren't quite as competitive, there's still fun to be had here, but stick to the lower player counts. For the most friendly, family-friendly experience, the most kind of silly fun, leave the menu cards out of the game as well and play with three players at the most.
Yeah, I still think we might be able to make a list of which cards leave out at higher player counts and then leave some of the menu cards in instead of dishing the deck entirely. But
now the big thing to watch for here is that Sushi Boat is not a silly laugh out loud party game. It's not a silly family weight game, or honestly, it's not a kid's game. While the theme and anime art might make you think of it as something lighter, there are a lot of hard decisions here, and memory element really does remove that. Let's hang out and play a silly game about sushi feel that I wanted from this game. Now, it doesn't happen often, but one thing I'm very tempted to do is add house rules to this game, especially the next time I bring it out to a public play a bit. Remove one less set of cards from the side dish deck. That'll give everyone one more turn. Remove some of the more difficult menu cards from the deck before playing. Perhaps even give player 3 yen at the start of the game. I feel that'll bring the game closer to what people expect from it.
Well, that's the end of our review of Sushi Boat from Japanime Games. It's not often we talk about house ruling a game, but doing so can be worth it, especially if it means that game can get to the table more often.
Do you have any house rules for your favorite games? What's a game you felt the need to change up, even if it's just a bit, to make it more fun for your group? Let us know about it in the comments, hit us up on social media, or tell Mo all about it by emailing mo@tabletopbellhop.com.